is a pleasure to see you all here this morning. Let's give the Lord a praise offering in form of those horns, shall we? Amen. Well, it is so wonderful to see you here this morning. A reminder that this Sunday starts our special collection to support the building of a women's dorm at Africa University. That's going to extend all the way through the month of February, so if you didn't bring an offering for that, that's okay today. You can either bring it on Sunday mornings, mark it Africa University, or just mail it to Ruth, marked Africa University, so whatever your pleasure is. That's a challenge from the conference in order to achieve $150 over the course of 3 years, but the conference has already met their goal, so now they're challenging everybody to try and do it all in 1 year. But it is going to support a women's dorm in an area where women can't safely walk to their university without being in danger, and therefore they wanted to build a dorm at that facility. This morning we continue our series, our mildly interrupted series, on the baptismal vows. And so this morning we will travel into the third portion of our baptismal vow. And as we had in the past, this opening litany will be a reflection of that vow that we say. So let's begin this morning by reciting our opening litany. God of grace, we proclaim the good news and seek daily to live as disciples of Jesus Christ, his body on earth. We confess Jesus Christ as our Savior, put our whole trust in his grace, and promise to serve him as our Lord, in union with the church, which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races. Amen. Let us worship this morning by singing Nothing But the Blood.
Love.
this morning, let us hear the entirety of the scripture that we have been working with during this time, since it has been a while since we've heard it. Matthew chapter 3, verses 13 through chapter 4, verse 11. Then Jesus came from Galilee to John at the Jordan to be baptized by him. John would have prevented him, saying, "I need to be baptized by you, and do you come to me?" But Jesus answered him, "Let it be so now, for it is proper for us in this way to fulfill all righteousness." Then he consented. And when Jesus had been baptized, just as he came up from the water, suddenly the heavens were opened to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting on him. And a voice from heaven said, "This is my Son, the Beloved, with whom I am well pleased." Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. He fasted 40 days and 40 nights, and afterwards he was famished. The tempter came and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." But he answered, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him up to the holy city and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone." Jesus said to him, "Again, it is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of all the world and their splendor. And he said to him, "All these I will give you if you will fall down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away with you, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him." Then the devil left him. This morning, as we have already collected our offering, let us praise God for that offering by joining in the doxology. This morning we lift before you the offering that we have given in your name. We give back but a portion of the gifts you have given us, gifts of time, of talent, of resources. And we ask that these be blessed to your service. We ask that you call down and come down and be with and transform and move among these gifts, the giver, and those who cannot give at this time, so that your work and your will and your message may be shared through these gifts in our church, in our community, and in the world. Lord, this morning we come before you as well in a time of prayer for the needs of our community. We lift especially before you this morning Linda, as she undergoes some more tests and a possible biopsy as they determine treatment options for the cancer in her hand. We lift before you Dell as she continues under comfort measures due to the after effects of COVID and the hospitalization. We continue to lift before you Karen's family member who is now out of the hospital but is determining what kind of treatment will be best. We continue to lift before you those who are on our prayer list, those who have suffered from COVID and are still recovering. We remember all of those today and lift them before you. Lord, we especially lift before you all of the organizations these cold temperatures, Lord, we know that some of them are meeting in gymnasiums and warehouses. So, Lord, we lift before you that process as we continue to roll out the vaccine. Lord, we lift before you all of our leaders as they make wise decisions and choices regarding continued lockdowns or continued curfews or opening other businesses that may not yet be open as they deal with a once-in-a-lifetime experience that they truly were not prepared to lead into. Lord, we lift them all before you for your care and your guidance and your wisdom. Lord, we take all of these concerns before you this morning and those on our hearts and our minds, and we lift them up to you. We place them in your hands, trusting you to provide hope and healing and rest and comfort. And Lord, we ask that you challenge us where we may be providers of those things to meet the needs of those around us. And we do this all in the name of Jesus Christ, the one whom we proclaim and who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us continue our worship by joining in singing, I Surrender All.
Freely give.
this morning, we continue our journey into the baptismal vows as we talk about confession. This morning's message is titled, I Confess, and we hear these words again. I confess Jesus Christ as my Savior, put my whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as my Lord in union with the church which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races. The word confess often has in the church a connotation of confessing something wrong we've done. If you're from a Catholic tradition or are familiar with the Catholic tradition, the concept of confession is a confession of sin, something that you go to the priest in order to absolve you of. But the word here that we're using is the more generic form of confess, simply meaning to speak, to say, to let the world know with our lips. Now, we have talked about how our actions are very important, and there is some aspect of confession of at least Jesus Christ as our Savior that is action. But today we focus on the words. We focus on the actual declaration of Jesus Christ as Savior and that promise to put our trust in His grace and serve Him as our Lord. This concept of confession, when we remove it from this definition of having to confess sin, simply means a proclamation of something that we agree to. It has a sense that this is more than just I said. I said can be very casual. It's more of a combination of a promise and a declaration at the same time. An agreement that you'll do something, but also something that you're proclaiming loud and proud. One of the things that Christians can often become caught up in is this sense of doing a lot for God, but when it comes down to it, not confessing a lot about God. Sometimes we forget the proclamation aspect of the vows that we have made and the promise that we have made as Christians. We forget that there is this need to proclaim, to speak, to say to whom our allegiance belongs, and to speak about Him to the people. We have seen the stories in countless newspapers and online articles throughout the years, and you're never really sure how much of it is 100% true, since it's an anecdote that's been passed down from generation to generation or from news source to news source. But you inevitably see the story of the person who's confronted by someone who wants to do violence and says, renounce Jesus Christ. And the person, knowing that they face death, says, I will not. These circumstances have occurred in our nation, in other nations, in generations and years before us. This sense of confession comes with this weight, this heaviness that there will be a time in our lives when it will be uncomfortable, maybe even dangerous, but definitely uncomfortable, to say, yes, we believe in Jesus Christ. And we as Christians are faced with those decisions more often than we realize, where we have opportunities to speak about God, and we have the choice to do so or to stay silent due to personal circumstances. Perhaps it's social awkwardness. Perhaps it's uncertainty about how the person will respond. Perhaps we don't want to make them angry. Perhaps we don't want to drive them away. Perhaps. There could be dozens of reasons why we would choose to stay silent when we have the opportunity to confess and proclaim who Jesus Christ is in our lives. So this morning, this is a challenge to evaluate, as we have been for the past several weeks, evaluate in your life where these things may be either lacking or maybe slacking in our lives. Once we hear these words and we say these words, we confess Jesus Christ as our Savior, the next words are we put our whole trust in His grace and promise to serve Him. Now we get a little bit of the action. The promise to serve Him we've talked about in the past few weeks, talking about resisting evil. But the put our whole trust in His grace is an important aspect of this vow. We put our trust in God's grace because we ourselves do not have the strength to do any of this without God's grace. We don't have the clout to do any of this without God's grace. We don't have the ability to do any of this. The strength to proclaim, the strength to confess, the drive to serve without the grace of God. A grace that was put in our lives long before we ever made a commitment. As a matter of fact, the baptismal vows, as I've mentioned, are often considered a means of grace. That's how Wesley liked to define them, a means of grace. A way by which grace is placed in our lives at the forefront. Yes, God's grace is always there, but this particular act really brings grace front and center. And so for those of us who were baptized as babies, that grace was brought front and center in our lives long before we ever knew who Jesus Christ was, and we could agree to this confession. And for those of us who weren't baptized as children, that grace was still there, even if we may not have seen it. And it is that grace that carries us through these promises. The latter part of this vow, in union with the church, which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races, we're going to conclude our series next week with the church. But I think it's very important to notice that here in this verse, or here in this vow, they have very specifically included this concept that we don't do this on our own. We don't do this running around and proclaiming something that we've just made up ourselves. We don't go out and spout something that has nothing to do with the church, but rather we do so in union with the church. Of course, this is the global church, the whole church in its entirety, the church of Jesus Christ in the world, which He has opened to people of all nations, ages, and races. See, this profession, this confession, this proclamation goes out to everyone. Not just a select few, not just a handful, not just those who we like or those who we're familiar with, but this goes out to everyone. When we confess Jesus Christ as our Savior, we have the opportunity to confess this and to proclaim this with everyone we meet. No one is excluded. That may be one of the times in our lives where we're uncertain whether we speak and profess Jesus Christ. Maybe we think, oh, they already have a religion in their country, or they're not worth it. They're too dirty. They're too sinful. They're too rough around the edges. Or, well, of course, they absolutely know Jesus. I mean, they're rich, and they've gone to church for years, and they just belong to church, and this absolutely, they must know Jesus. And there are plenty of circumstances where age, nation, and race can be a barrier to why we choose to confess or not confess Jesus Christ. These vows make certain we have no excuse. No excuse not to proclaim Jesus Christ as our Savior. We're supported by His grace. meaning we can do this with help. We don't have to do it alone. We're doing this as a promise to a person we have committed our lives to as Lord. And we do so with the backing of the Church Eternal. And we have no limits on who we can tell. These words tell us that these vows that we take are not just internal vows, and not just vows that cause us to act out in our lives the work of Christ, but also to speak it, to boldly shout it from the proverbial rooftops, from every opportunity that we have, with no limitations, no restrictions, no terms and conditions. And so this morning, as I have over the past few weeks, I challenge us to look into our lives, to find the places where maybe the confession, the proclamation has been lacking. Maybe look at the reasons why we have failed to profess Jesus as our Savior and as the Savior of the world, and to prayerfully consider those circumstances. Now, let me be clear, there is wisdom in knowing when to share and when not to share. There are times when it would not necessarily be appropriate to share, perhaps when someone is having a personal circumstance or a personal issue that they don't know how to deal with. It isn't always beneficial to say, well, Jesus can solve that for you. There are times that we do have to be careful in how we say things and know the tactful circumstances to use it. So I'm not saying that in every interaction we look for an opportunity to stick Jesus in the conversation, regardless of how well that would go, but rather that we evaluate every single conversation and situation we have in our lives and look whether there would have been an opportunity. Look for that opening, an opening that is not harmful, but is beneficial. I've said before, and I'll say it again, being a Christian is hard. Sometimes we commit to this life of Christ and we don't realize how much we signed up for. This challenge is a challenge to evaluate our lives, to look at these vows that we have proclaimed in one form or another, and to say, am I upholding my end of the deal? Christ supports us with his grace. He gives us, the church and those around us, to give us strength and give us support and give us knowledge. But we are called to profess his name, to confess, to speak out loud and proclaim who he is to us and to the world. And so we close with the song that has been our theme song, and we will see one more week. I am resolved, as we indeed re-agree, re-examine, and re-confess our resolve to follow and to proclaim Jesus Christ.
I will hasten to
May you go trusting in His grace and serving Him as your Lord as you confess and proclaim Christ Savior to the world. Amen and amen. Have a blessed week. See you all next week.